You're listening to the Straight to Video Podcast with Rob Lane.
Hey there, welcome on board for another episode of the Straight to Video Podcast. Today's guest is a true rock and roll underground survivor. Blasting in all the way from New York's capital of Albany is Mike Trash of the Erotics. So way back in the early 2000s, when I was writing for Trash Pit magazine, I received a press kit from out of nowhere from Mike, which included his band's latest CD, All That Glitters Is Dead, and I was immediately hooked. Two reasons. The music was great. Right from the start, the opening track, Space Age Mafia, is such a cool sleaze rock song, and to this day, one of my favourite Erotics tunes. And then, in the liner notes of the album, it had a headline which said something along the lines of, "The Erotics are already banned in your hometown." This two-punch combo meant I was all in. Over the next few months, Mike and I would keep in touch, and eventually we got onto the subject of The Erotics coming to the UK for some shows. This was around the time our band Teenage Casket Company were really starting to find our feet, so I put him in touch with our guitarist Jamie Delericht, who was great at putting tours together, and we arranged for what we dubbed an international gig swap. Mike and his band would come to the UK, they sort their flights out and we'll do the rest. We book the shows, transport, they use all our gear, just get their asses over. In return, they would do the same for us in the USA. Back then, it was one of the biggest and most important things I've ever been involved in, and really was the beginning of a friendship with a band that has lasted over 15 years. They're also responsible for the drunkest night of my entire life, but that's another story. The Erotics continue to be one of the most productive underground hard rock bands I know, and next year celebrate their 25th anniversary. I'm sure a return visit to the UK will be on the cards. You can find out more about Mike and The Erotics over at their website www.eroticrockandroll.com, where you can pick up endless amounts of merch and their two latest releases, The Songs Remain Deranged and Let's Kill Rock and Roll. So, with Halloween just around the corner, I'd like to play you guys the straight-to-video song that Mike Trash was involved with a couple of years ago. It was great to finally get in the studio and have Mike lay down some vocals on a cover of the Wasp tune Scream Until You Like It, which was originally on Ghoulies 2 way back in 1988. Mike has the perfect voice for this kind of stuff, so hope you enjoy this one, and it's best listened to loud.
Don't be afraid to go.
That was the straight-to-video version of Scream Until You Like It, originally by Wasp, which we released a few years ago, and it's available for free download if you want to grab it. I'll put a link in the episode notes of this podcast. So, here we go. Mike is a guy who usually lets the music do the talking, and he's a man of a few words, but he has some great stories about his early days and also joining the band Lethal Lipstick, which would see him signing his first record deal and taking things out to Hollywood and getting a taste of the Sunset Strip rock scene of the late 80s and early 90s. Hope you enjoy it. Grow up in and around Albany, because I think you mentioned before that you weren't actually born there, but that's where you're from.
Yeah, I was born an hour north of Albany, Glens Falls, New York. That's where my mother's from. Her side of the family's from there. And long story short, she went to labor when she was pregnant for me, so she had to be rushed to the Glens Falls Hospital. She was just visiting my grandmother, and so I was born a little bit earlier than expected. So
came out kicking and screaming early.
Yeah, I know. Not too much early, about 2 weeks premature. Not horrible, but she thought she could have time to visit, you know, and nothing.
Mike was on his way.
My birth certificate says Glens Falls, New York, because of that reason. But most of my life I lived in Albany.
What's Glens Falls like? Somewhere I've never been.
Jamie Delaric knows it, because when I mentioned I'm from there, he knows a famous wrestler that's from there. So of course he knows about it. Hacksaw Jim Duggan is a popular WWE wrestler that's from Glens Falls.
Oh, that's where he's from. Legend.
Yeah.
So what do you remember about growing up around Albany and stuff like that? Was it a cool place to grow up?
Yeah, I mean, the neighborhood I grew up in, you know, me and my friends in the same street and a couple blocks away, always did the usual stuff kids would do in the 70s, you know, just getting a lot of trouble and smash windows in abandoned buildings and stuff, you know, and stuff like that, and play with Star Wars action figures and all that crap. Then some of the older kids would play, you know, some rock records for us, and that's when we started, you know, getting intrigued by that. And
where were those guys from? Just the cooler, older kids?
Same neighborhood, probably 4 or 5 years older, you know, and playing Kiss for us and stuff, and I don't remember who else, but I think Van Halen.
What kind of music had you heard before then? What was it, just like pop radio, or what kind of stuff was you used to hearing?
AM radio, which you could still get AM radio in your cars and stuff in America, but FM became popular towards the mid to late 70s, but my mother always listened to the AM, and like Elton John, Stevie Wonder, and just random singles I used to like, and my mother would take me to the record store if I liked it, and I'd buy me the 45, you know.
Can you remember the first record she brought you? Which you actually wanted. Like, I've heard this one. I want to go buy it.
The full album might have been Elton John. I think I got his greatest hits. I remember around 1975 or 76, he had like a ton of songs in the top 20, like on constant radio rotation back then, you know, and I liked a lot, happened to like a lot of them. So my mother got me the whole album, and for some reason I took a liking to Stevie Wonder. And then when the hard rock thing came in, it was Alice Cooper, because he had a ballad called I Never Cry, which came out, I think, 76 or 77. So my mother bought me that single. And on the B-side was the title track, Go to Hell, to the album Go to Hell. And I'm sure you heard that song. Picture being 8 years old listening to that for the first time. And terrifying at first, but I couldn't stop listening to it. And I'd have my friends come over to listen to it. I could listen to what he's singing about. He's singing about stealing a blind man's cane and stuff like that and poisoning his dog.
What was the artwork on the single? Can you remember?
The artwork was just palm trees and, you know, the Warner Brothers logo. And that's one of the records.
Okay, right. So it's just one of those generic ones. So you had no idea what you was getting into.
There was no album cover whatsoever. I had no idea what he even looked like at that point.
Wow. And at what point did you see a photograph of him?
National Enquirer. You ever hear that? There's like a tabloid. I remember my mother showed it to me because this guy's disgusting. He calls himself Alice. Then maybe a month or two later, that's when we heard him on the radio. And she said, oh, that's actually a really pretty song. One of my friend's older brothers said, oh, if you like that, you like this one even better. And he like put on, I think it was Alice Cooper's Greatest Hits. It came out a year or two before that. That had all the, you know, the ones that are dressed like gangsters, the cartoon picture. He like played me someone else on it. Cool stuff, you know.
Game over after that then.
Yeah, then Kiss came after that. And I was watching a Halloween special and I had no idea who Kiss was and they were on it. Of Paul Lynn, the comedian. And I remember my cousin was visiting. It was Halloween weekend. And he already was a Kiss freak because he's a few years younger. He was well onto him. But I had no idea who they were. And I'm like, oh, at first I didn't know what to make of it, you know. But
had you seen, you've not seen any pictures of them or anything like that?
No, I thought I saw them on TV.
He's like, shit, I should have dressed up for them as Halloween.
I know. And it was like, again, once again, one of the neighbors had, his older brother had some Kiss albums and we went to his house, he was playing them all. And that's when I started gravitating more towards hard rock. It just touched me more than, you know, other kinds of music.
What was the big Kiss album at the time? Can you remember?
Destroyer, probably.
Oh, wow. Right. So proper getting into the heyday where it was proper exploding.
Yeah, I think they played three songs from Destroyer when they played on the Paul Lynn special. Because you actually find it on YouTube now. You type in Paul Lynn Halloween special and Kiss plays. And remember the Wicked Witch from The Wizard of Oz? She's also in the special and dancing to one of the Kiss songs. It's kind of funny.
Was Halloween a big thing when you was a kid?
Oh yeah, it still is. I'm sure you know. I still have a lot of the same decorations from the 70s that I held on to from my parents or whatever. Instead of throwing them away, I said, no, I want them. Yeah.
They're proper collectible antique things, probably worth some money, man.
Yeah, some are from the year I was born. Some are from the mid-70s. They had the year imprints on some of them still. Probably after I get done talking to you, I'm probably going to start put the decorations up. I'm already a day late.
It's October. You got it. So who did you used to dress up as at Halloween? Once you got into rock music, did you ever do Alice Cooper or Kiss or anything?
But before I got into the music, you know, I was Frankenstein 1 year. And funny because I was Frankenstein as my adult years too, dressing up. 1 year I was Wolfman. 1 year I was a superhero. Shazam, you remember Shazam? I think I was Casper the Ghost, my first costume when I was like 3 or 4. Fourth grade was Gene Simmons. I dressed like Gene.
Sweet. You ain't got any photos of that, have you?
I might somewhere. We took Polaroids and I got to dig them up somewhere.
That'd be amazing. So when was your first gig which you actually saw? Did any actually come through Albany or did you have to travel a little bit further afield?
Glens Falls was the big Civic Center arena in the 70s and 80s. Surprisingly, Albany, even though it's the capital, did not have an arena until 1990. Like a couple surrounding towns had arenas. You had to drive to them. We had a theater, the Palace Theater, and Proctor's and others. Once in a while, bands would play the smaller theaters, and we'd be excited because we didn't have to take a long drive, you know. But I think the very first concert I saw was Kiss, Creatures of the Night, and it was in the middle of a huge snowstorm. You talk about an hour drive, you know, because I remember it was January of 83. My friend's dad that was driving us up still said, screw it, we're going, you know, and it still went. And it wasn't a big turnout. It wasn't because of lack of ticket sales either. It was like a lot of people didn't make the show because they didn't want to drive in the snow.
Do you have any idea about what to expect with like the big stage show or anything like that?
I mean, it was my first concert, so it looked like a million people to me. But I guess years later, I found out only 2,000 people were there at an 8,000 seat arena.
Is that when they had like the big tank?
Yeah, I remember the stage show was crazy, you know. I remember you could feel the heat from the flames, even if you're way back. I still remember that.
Who was on guitar then? Was Vinnie Vincent?
Yeah, a lot of fans were disappointed because they didn't really tell a lot of people Ace wasn't there. But the next thing you know, you go to the merch stall and Vinnie's on the shirts. Everybody's like, who the hell is that guy? You know,
that makeup sucks.
They lied and said that he was just filling in because Ace got in a car accident, which wasn't true. He just said that because they didn't want, I guess, for legal reasons, so they would have lost their record deal. But I found out years later. I guess whatever record deal they got had to have three members of the original four, and they didn't want to tell anybody that Ace left.
Who supported him? Did you get to see the support band?
It was Night Ranger for their debut album. I still remember that.
Can you remember much of their set? Did you enjoy him?
I just remember excited seeing the guitar player because he just got done playing with Ozzy, Brad Gillis. And I never seen an MTV special on Halloween a couple months earlier. Ozzy and Brad Gillis was the guitar player, and he was wearing the same outfit, same red guitar and everything. It was no mistake who he was, you know. I'm like, oh, that's Ozzy's guitar player.
Sweet. So you're already getting like consumed into the whole rock world and everything. Yeah. Was you trying to consume as much information as you could?
Definitely, yeah.
Was it like, what magazines were around at that time?
Hit Parader, Circus, Cream. They were the three main ones. And if you went to like the independent record shops, you could find Kerrang.
Yeah.
Which I remember some of my friends used to start reading it. And I go over to their house and what's that? I never even, you just start finding about other bands you never even heard of before. That So you get only the independent shops would carry.
Did you have like a local record shop in Albany or did you have to travel? Was that like a New York City thing?
Yeah, we did. There was one called World's Records, which carried all the imported stuff. Sometimes you just bought records by chance because you liked the way the album cover looked. And some of them were god-awful. Some of them were good, you know. Some had cool names.
What was the best treasure that you found where you thought you took a chance on it and it turned out to be awesome?
There's a band called TKO. Remember them? Mm-hmm. They're from the United States, though, but they were just in the independent shops. They kind of reminded me of, like, you know, an AC/DC or something like that. And Sing Wrathchild, the UK version, buying the album, think it would be cool and not really liking the music on it, but it's grown on me over the years. But at the time when I first heard it, I was like,
didn't do the trick for you. You've stayed an Alice Cooper fan pretty much all the way through, right? Followed him through every kind of incarnation. What's been your favorite album or tour or anything like that?
I think the most recent time I seen him in concert was 2 years ago. It was hands down the best time I saw him.
Yeah,
it was about 2 years ago this time. Like, it was October. Same band that he's had, and the band just gets better and better live. And I saw that lineup about two times before that, but this last time was the best time.
He's just got it dialed in, that guy. He just knows the score, he really does.
First time I saw Alice Cooper was in 1986 for the Constrictor. It was his comeback tour, and it was with Kip Winger on bass.
Oh, shit, how was that? You know I'm into that.
No one had any idea who he was, you know, but I just remember seeing his name in the back of the album, and he's on the tour program, and then a year or two later, his band Winger comes out, and I'm like, I wonder if that's the same guy, you know, and then we found out it was.
That's cool, man, nice one. So, being from Albany, how big a deal was it, perhaps more as a kid, but how big a deal was it to actually go into New York City, and when was the first time you actually went there?
It was in my teens. First time I'd have been on a school trip, you know, just to go down this. I think we saw a theater play or something. I can't remember what one it was, but I just never seen, you know, you being going in New York City for the first time is definitely overwhelming for anybody, I guess. Once in a while, when I got a little older, we should drive down and go to shows. If they didn't make it up to Albany, we'd go down there to see a show.
Do you like the whole vibe of the city?
Yeah, and at some point I lived there for a little while when I was with Lethal Lipstick, and it was fun. It was a great scene for a little while. We got the tail end of the good scene when we moved down, you know.
What clubs were like the big deal then?
It was the Limelight, I'm sure you heard of. It used to be a church. The stage was on the altar. We got to play there a bunch of times. It was awesome. The Cat Club, L'Amour's. L'Amour's was in Brooklyn. That wasn't in Manhattan. The Scrap Bar in Manhattan, which it didn't really have bands. It was just a hangout bar, but it was still fun. And you always ran into, it was kind of like the New York version of the Rainbow. You know, you always run into somebody. You know, Lemmy or Slash, or, you know, I remember Christian Slater was there once, you know, the actor. Just random, you never would be there, just showing up, you know.
So whereabouts did you live in New York? Because New York's, I'm not overly familiar, but it's just one of those places where it's reasonably small in some terms, but there's so many different areas.
We lived in the Bronx because we found a rehearsal loft that we could live in and practice at the same time for really cheap, because it was a lot cheaper there than Manhattan. There was only people like us for miles. It was all urban area, you know, so. But we got along. Everybody loved us because they said, what the hell are these crazy guys doing here, you know?
And this is with Lethal Lipstick, right?
Yeah. And it was only a 20-minute ride to Manhattan, so it wasn't that bad.
So how did you get to join that band? How was the whole process? Because you actually joined them. It wasn't a band you formed.
No, they were together for maybe 2-3 years. They already had a name for themselves, not just Albany, but a lot of the Northeast area. I used to rehearse with one of my other bands around a rehearsal room around the corner from at a gas station where the singer for Lethalistic worked at. And I went in there, I think, to get gas and maybe get a soda or something. And I recognized him, talked to him for a second, and didn't think anything of it. And then I remember the manager of the rehearsal studio telling me, yeah, you should really try out for Lethalistic. They lost their guitar player. All right. And so I remember the next time I went to the gas station, I gave him a demo tape of the band I was in, which is the band was called Sick Ticket. And I didn't think nothing of it, dropped it off to him, and never heard from him. So then maybe they didn't like it or they found somebody else, you know. And then maybe 2 weeks later, I went back to get gas, and he's like, you didn't have your phone number on your tape. And I thought it was already label printed on there, but I guess that one didn't have it. And because those songs are great, we'd love to have you come down and jam. And I think I rehearsed with them 2 or 3 times. And then they said, you want to be the guy? It's perfect because you live in Albany. We're from Albany. They were looking for guitar players out of the area because they couldn't find anybody for a perfect fit, which is very strange, you know. Everybody just wanted to play thrash or Grateful Dead, or a lot of people like glam rock, but no one had the balls to look the part and play it. So it was kind of hard to find, you know what I mean? So I was one of the guys that didn't care to look that way, so it worked out, you know.
Who was kind of the big band which was kind of exploding, which you was perhaps not necessarily modeling yourselves on, but who was kind of like the hot band around that time? Was it like Motley Crue, or was it some other bands as well?
We liked Motley Crue. LA Guns is really exploding at the time when I joined Lethalistic. Believe it or not, during that time, I was more of an LA Guns fan than a Motley Crue fan. I liked Motley Crue, but I think I was just sick of them at that point because I listened to them a lot. Oh, this is Nowhere Fresher. I like this more, you know, stuff like that. And Faster Pussycat was the other band that were kind of like...
We're kind of like late 80s then now. We're like 87, 88 kind of time.
Yeah, and then there's like little lesser known ones like Smash Gladys we liked a lot. I don't know if you remember them. Bang Tango and the Sea Hags and the Throbs and Electric Angels. Liked all those bands. And I, ironically, we played with all of them even back then when they were in their heyday. So it was kind of cool playing on the same stage going on right before them, you know, when they were not 30 years later to 40 people in a bar, you know. You're playing packed house day, you know, whatever, how many people.
How was those bands back then? Was they pretty, was they cool with the support bands?
Yeah, we never had a problem with anybody.
How was you getting the gigs? Was it the promoters knew that you'd be able to draw quite a few people, and or did you have a manager back then?
Well, some gigs we booked our own, or some of the club owners would call us up and say, you'd be perfect. So-and-so's coming to town. We'd like to have you open up or all that. And yeah, we did land with a pretty big management company when that was 1989. We went to L.A. for one of those hard rock conventions, and we met him there, and he worked with us for like 3 years.
Wow. How was it for you going out to LA and Hollywood for the first time? Did you have any like preconceived ideas about what it was going to be like?
It was like everything that you thought it was going to be, and you saw it on TV and all those documentaries with the hard rock bands. As soon as you got off the plane and got out the tarmac and saw all the palm trees, and I think it was like 40 degrees when we left Albany that day. It was for some reason it was really cold in September, you know. So we land there a few hours later to California. It's 80 degrees out and beautiful and sunny, you know.
Where did you stay when you was out there? Do you remember?
Yeah, we stayed at the same hotel where the convention was held at. So it was like a constant party. There was like thousands of people from all over the world, from all aspects of the industry. It's like well-known bands, record labels, magazines, you know, radio, all of. And we like pretty much connected with a lot of those people. Some of them I still talk to this day. I think that's why I still have connections to do stuff, because of the stuff like that.
Yeah.
Message somebody, hey, I got a new album out, I want to play it on the radio, and they'll play it, you know, and stuff like that.
It's almost like in today's world, it's so easy to connect with people, but that connection perhaps won't last. Whereas back then, when you met somebody face to face or through an old school way, like say, those connections have lasted.
There wasn't even cell phones yet, let alone internet. Yeah. I don't know how we did anything we did. I can't even, it hurts my head to even think about how we got all that stuff done without the internet, but we did it.
All just by friggin' snail mail and landlines, really.
Yeah, I remember reading the newspapers and stuff. Some used to be like big weekly newspapers that had all like the venues in there that had all the shows coming up, and you just take a chance to call them and see about if they'd be interested in booking you. And most of the time, they're really cool people, and you just gotta either meet them in person and drop off the press kit, or if they're really far away, you mail it off, and you'd have to wait a few weeks to see if they listen to it and give them follow up. Not like now, you can just send them a digital file and they can listen to it in 10 minutes and let you know right away. Yeah.
It's insane, isn't it? It really is insane.
Yeah.
Did you play any shows when you were out there that first time?
We were just out there just to meet people and connect, and just me and two other guys went, and And then we went the following year, just for the hell of it, for the same convention, just to party, you know, and just hang out with people.
Was you noticing, like, a change? You say that first time you said that was 89. Was you noticing a change? Because I mean, I guess hard rock was still pretty big until, like, even into 92, really.
I remember going to the Sunset Strip the first time in 89. We went on a Thursday or Friday night, and it was just like the way you see it in that Metal Years video. Exactly. And we were like there seeing it for real in person, you know what I mean? There's like so many bands just handing you flyers and everybody's throwing them on the ground and all that kind of stuff. And it was kind of cool, you know?
Because you've been friends with like Stevie Rochelle from Tough and Metal Sludge for a long time. When did you guys first meet?
1989. It was at that very convention. And then we ran into him later on the Sunset Strip. Him and the drummer, I forgot the drummer's name, Mike or Michael or something.
Yeah, Michael Lean, was it?
Yeah. They were just hanging out, just handing out postcards for something. I mean, they had a show coming.
They'd have still been working it. That's before their Atlantic deal and stuff, I would imagine.
Yeah, nobody could believe they weren't even signed yet at that point because they had such a big buzz and they were already around the world and not known well and stuff. And then we actually played with them at the Cat Club in New York.
Oh, sweet.
When that album came out.
How was that show?
That was a cool show. I still remember. It was like 1991. They had the hit song at the time and definitely a cool thing. And then many years later, we found out he ran Metal Sludge. And
yeah, that was like a big secret for a while.
Yeah. And I got talking to him and mentioned who I was, and he remembered right away, and we've been in touch. And as you know, we toured with him too. And I still send him new stuff every time we put new stuff out, and he gives us a shout out for it and stuff.
Yeah, he's one of the good guys, I think. Very, very shrewd and very good businessman, yeah. But he is one of the good dudes, I think, really is. So how did Lethal Lipstick kind of ride the wave of the turn in music? Was it something you were able to do, or was that what led to the band falling apart?
Yeah, we ended up getting a deal ourselves through a MCA-based label. It was a subsidiary. I think they were called, I should remember, because it was a big deal at the time. They were called Maze. And I remember the big band at the time that they had was Biohazard. I don't know if you remember. Even though they were hardcore, they're still pretty big. You know, people still regard them as for that kind of music, you know, but the one guy that really dug us and wanted to sign us, so he had to bring the president to come see us play, and the president ended up liking it and giving him the okay to sign us. And that was October of 1991. By December, they decided that they didn't want to like put the album out because things changed like that fast at the end of 1991. It was crazy.
Had you actually started recording anything at that point?
Yeah, we did.
And how far along the line did that process go? Was it just like pre-production and stuff?
We did the full album, but didn't get a proper mix, but it is floating around. Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. Some of the songs might be up on the Reverb Nation page, Lethal Lipstick, I think. I think the singer, Nick, uploaded them a while back.
Are you still in touch with those guys then?
One guy lives in Florida, the bass player lives in LA, and Nick lives in the area, but I think he lives in Florida too. He goes back and forth. A lot of New Yorkers go back and forth to Florida for some reason. It's a weird thing. I don't know what it is.
Once the kind of old record label thing went south, did you guys stay together much longer, or was that kind of
We stayed together maybe 6 months later, and I think we're just deflated by the whole thing not working out. Everybody just lost their motivation. The fire wasn't there anymore. Even every time we tried to rehearse, it just seemed like we're beating a dead horse. Just nothing was happening. So we just decided to bowl it. And me and the singer started another band. We moved back to Albany, actually. We started another band. It was almost similar, but a little bit more punkier. And it was a lot of fun, but it just fizzled out really fast. And I ended up starting this band I'm in still.
Was that something you had in your head? Like, I'm going to be the singer frontman?
The only reason I did it, because we couldn't find anybody else. I knew I could sing, because even in the studio, all the producers would always say, you know, you have a great voice, you should be a lead singer someday, blah, blah. And I had no interest in it. I'm fine just doing backups, you know. But when I started this band, we couldn't find a singer. I said, fuck it, I'll do it. You know, it's kind of funny because sometimes I'm more known as a singer than a guitar player, but I'm a guitar player first in my head.
Did you take like the punk elements and put that into the Erotics as well? Because you've kind of got this nice mashup, really. You've always been kind of associated with hard rock and sleaze rock, but there's a definite punk edge to it as well.
The very first album, Born to Destroy, is very, very Ramones style punk, and that's what we wanted to do, you know, because it was 1996 and we didn't want to scare everybody away if we went full-blown like Motley Crue or something, you know. It was like, But a couple of years later, that's why I started wanting to go back towards that direction. And the lineup of that band were mad at me. They all like quit. No, you're selling out. We just want to play punk and blah, blah, blah. And that was that. And they all went out and did their punk bands. And I started gradually going more hard rock and more sleaze and a little bit more classic rock. But still has a little, once in a while, there's a little touch of punk here and there. But
that must be the New York dripping in.
Yeah, no, yeah.
How long's the Erotics been together now?
1996, so it's 24 years.
Any plans for 25th celebration? You got to do something.
Yeah, we're thinking about it in February. That's when the band was formed, in February 96.
So after almost 25 years, I know there have been times when you've struggled continuing the band. You've become disillusioned or deflated at the time because of everything that's going on in the industry and being an underground band. But you've always come back stronger and more determined than before. What is it that continues to keep fueling that?
That's a tough question. I get to ask that a lot. I don't know what keeps me going. I feel burned out and deflated once in a while. And all right, I guess I'm going to, you know, take some time off, recharge my batteries. Maybe I'll take a year off. Maybe I'll take 6 months off. You know, next thing you know, it's 4 weeks later. Oh, I got to get playing again. You know, so it's always short lived, the breaks I take.
I think that's probably it. I mean, you just do get burnt out and it's like, right, just need to step away. I think the instant reaction is I'm done with it. But I think it's just you just need to step away from it for a while and get that fire back, because that fire is always there. For someone like yourself who's been doing it so long, that fire's never going to go out. It's what you do. It's what you are, really.
Definitely. This whole lockdown has been good. I could take a break and realize how much I want it back in my life now. You know, we've been getting some good news. Some places have been allowed to open again in the area and have live music. Just 2 days ago, a federal judge declared the lockdown for live music unconstitutional, lifted the ban. So it was like a big fuck you to the governor.
After 25 years, how do you go about picking an erotic set list these days?
Right now, we're doing it. Every song from the new album, which is 14 tracks, and a handful of the classics, you know, just mixed in. I'm sure next year we'll probably cut some of the new ones out. But right now we're so excited with all the new songs, we're playing all of them.
Awesome, man. All right, dude. Well, you take care. Always good to see you.
Good seeing you, Rob. Take care.
Always great to hear from the one and only Mike Trash of the Erotics, and I'm excited to see what he has planned for the band in 2021 as they celebrate their 25th anniversary. Don't forget to visit eroticrockandroll.com to keep up to date on what the band have in store, and hopefully we'll get to see them live again next year. For now, thanks to all you guys for all the support. I know I say it every episode, but it really does fuel things and keeps me pushing things forward. Hope you're all keeping well and looking after yourselves and one another. So until next time, I've been your host, Rob Lane, and this has been the Straight to Video podcast. I'll speak to you all real soon.